Hi, welcome everyone to our International Pediatric Simulation Society August webinar series. So happy to have all of you here. My name is Christine Bailey. I'm the Education Committee Co-Chair. I just want to let you know that we are recording. This webinar will be available for future viewing and stored in our library of webinars. So please check them out in our IPSS Members Resource Center, so you can access other webinar recordings as well. I would like to tell you everyone, we have you muted and you can have your cameras on or off. Definitely at the end, we'll take questions and we'll have a question and answer session. And at that time, I would encourage everyone to turn your cameras on and ask some questions. If you are unable to turn your camera on for whatever reason, then please feel free to type any comments or questions in the chat. So again, we'll hold all the comments and questions till the end. And I want to let our speakers introduce themselves. And this is going to be a really good session. And I didn't even tell you what the topic is. So this is Make Your Own Task Trainers, Cutaneous Abscess IND and Foreign Body Removal. And I will hand this over to David Eckert and his team.
All right. Thank you very much, Christine. We're excited to be with you here today for the webinar. We are going to take a little different approach. We have a PowerPoint, but we're actually going to share that with all the viewers afterwards. And for this part, we just want to talk about our Abscess Task Trainer and demonstrate how to make it. And the idea of this is very much so that you will be able to do this on your own at your own institution. So between the video and the PowerPoint, it'll have all the details that you need. We'll tell you the exact materials that we're using, and there'll be measurements and whatnot in the PowerPoint. So hopefully it's a very practical application. So before we go any further, just want to let you know that none of the three of us have any financial disclosures to report. And I am David Eckert. I am a member of IPSS, have been for many years on the Education Committee and other capacities. So I am a faculty at the PA program here at Rocky Vista in just outside of Denver, Colorado. And I've been doing simulation for almost 14 years now, and most recently I've come to work with my esteemed colleagues here, and we're telling you this is our sim garage, where we're experimenting. We work with our fellows constantly trying to improve our task trainers and our techniques so that we can better educate our PA and our DO physician students. So I'm gonna hand it over to Dr. Simon.
Hi, I'm Brad Simon. I'm an emergency physician by training. Spent 30 years practicing. And about a little over 2 years ago, I decided to have a bit of a career change and joined the University here in Parker, Colorado. And currently, I'm the acting director of the Simulation Center here. And it has been a lot of fun working down here. Some very creative people, and we have lots of fun. And as David said, we try to drag in some of the fellows and students to help with these projects, and we have to give them some recognition on the paper. But they were really, really helpful in getting this project going and keeping it moving forward. And they had a lot of fun, I think, experimenting along the way with us. I'm going to let Thomas introduce himself.
Thank you, Dr. Simon, Chef Simon. Thomas Edward Jackson III, I'm a certified healthcare simulation operations specialist. My role here at Rocky Vista University, I'm the healthcare simulation technology specialist. I've been here for 2.5 years. I've been doing involved with simulation for about 12 years. Prior to that, in my other life, I worked in the entertainment industry, in motion pictures, theater, and film productions. Here at Rocky Vista, what we do is, I like to say, imaginative, creative, and innovative. So we are always looking to better ways to teach our students through task trainers, through different modalities. So this is Welcome to Sims Garage. We're going to cook something special up for you today. We've got a great recipe, and we will share that with you shortly.
So this story really started about 2.5 years ago when I first joined Rocky Vista. One of the first events I did was with Professor Eckhart and his PA students. We were running a lab for foreign body removal and abscess drainage. And what we were pieces of raw steak with toothpicks embedded to try to do the foreign body part. And that was okay. We wrapped it in, you know, plastic wrap to make it a little cleaner. And then our abscess material was just some, I believe we're either using mayonnaise or sour cream, I can't even remember, in a little Tex balloon with a piece of skin stretched over. I'm getting there, dude.
Yummy.
Yeah. So anyway, when it all got said and done, I was less than happy with the results. Part of it being before going to medical school and starting my journey in medicine, I did work in a microbiology lab in the food industry. So foodborne illnesses are really near and dear to me, kind of a weird thing to say, but I have this aversion to handling raw animal products, and that kind of kicked things off. And the other thing that we, as we were just saying, increased the realism. So we put our heads together, we formed a team, we got a couple of students involved, and we came up with a list of things that we thought were important for a task trainer of this. First thing we did, we looked at the literature, and there's some beautiful articles written using all kinds of wonderful materials. I mean, polenta and paintballs and mayonnaise and, I mean, you name it. Some of the studies, some of my favorite actually used fresh, in terms of live cadaver, doesn't make sense, a fresh cadaver where they would tunnel a catheter under the skin so you could ultrasound it, and you had, I think they used mayonnaise, maple syrup, I can't even remember what their particular plus formula was. But that's not practical for our university for a variety of reasons. First and foremost, we have a rather large student body. Between the College of Medicine program and our PA program, we're over 400 students. So trying to get enough fresh cadavers to have 400 students practice is just completely impractical. So again, we decided, okay, what do we want out of this project? So we looked at some of the commercial products that were on the market, and we decided, hey, what's out there? Most of them were very nice. I have to admit, there were some issues with some of them in that some of them you couldn't ultrasound. We felt it was important to include that step in the process. Some of them were single use only. And, you know, talk about the waste of, you know, medical product. Granted, it's clean, but use it once, throw it out. We wanted something that we could use again and again and again, and also decided, hey, you know, if we can make it multi-purpose. So instead of just teaching abscess drainage, we wanted it to be abscess and foreign body. We had some things that we wanted to make sure we could accomplish. First, no raw animal products, no cadavers, and no foodstuffs, if at all possible. And a lot of that was food waste driven and just sanitary things. We wanted it to be reusable, so that way people that are in low resource areas can use it again and again and again, you know, make it once and use it again. We wanted it multi-purpose, as I said, and we wanted to increase the fidelity and realism. I'm a successful simulation. The more steps of the procedure you can complete in simulation, the more likely you're going to do those things in the real world. So we wanted to make sure you could do every step along the way from cleaning it, numbing it, and, you know, cutting it, ultrasounding every step. We wanted it, as I said, to be ultrasound capable. That is an important part of the process, both for foreign body removal as well as for abscess and cellulitis. And we wanted it to be low cost. Again, you know, some of these products on the market, they're beautiful, but some of them are upwards of $1,400 in price. So again, if we're talking about 400 students, it just gets cost prohibitive to run these things in this way. So that led us to inventing this task trainer. We published a paper, actually, I think it's going into publication beginning of September. It should be released in publication. But we got together and we decided, hey, let's go do this. Let's have fun with it. And I'm gonna turn this over to Thomas to actually take you guys through the steps of the process.
Okay, again, welcome to SimGarage. Yeah, when I landed here at RBU, the meat products, I just really got grossed out of it. I had some previous experience working with silicone. Don't forget your gloves. You'd like to wear gloves with working with these materials. Although they're not toxic, they get quite sticky and messy. So what we're going to need first, we're going to need our silicone. This is called Dragon Skin Pro. It is a smooth-on material. You can go online and find it. Usually there's Advanced Materials here in Colorado carries this. We get it in the gallon size because we've been using a lot of it. It does come in a smaller trial size. Less expensive. You would probably build about 4 of these units out of a smaller. We usually get about 15 of these or 20 of these out of a gallon. So you'll need this to start with. You want to have your release agent, which I'll show you that in a minute. You want to spray that. I'll show you how that works. You want your container. These containers are just food containers. You can get them at Amazon. I've got these on Amazon. Very inexpensive. You can get 100 of them for very, very cheap. You're going to need some, you're going to need some mixing cups. Okay, you're going to need some stirrers to put your silicone in and mix with. You want to get some color. This is called Silk Pig. Yes, Silk Pig. It's a color silicone. It will color your pigment into your silicone. And that's really all you need. You need some gloves, of course. A couple other tools. You'll figure it out as you go. Let's get mixing. Let me show you how to mix these things. So for your base layer, you're going to have your muscle layer. So what you want to do, your muscle layer, you need your container. You want to spray it with the release agent. Get a good spray in there. You might want to wear a mask. It's a little stinky in it. Good. You should wear a mask with this stuff. You want to get a good spray in here. You want to get your mixing cup. It's 2-part silicone. So you want to mix part A and part B. And we do have the recipe up that we're going to share with you guys. It's about 250 milliliters per part, per B. So you mix them in separate containers. You want to mix them thoroughly. Get a good mix. Get them real mixed, real thorough. A and B. Mix them both. And then you have a third cup where you'll mix A and B into the third cup. And then you'll add your Silk Pig, your coloring into that. A little dab of Duya, just a small amount, goes a long way. So you mix that into your 2 parts, mix it really well, get it color, and then you'll pour that into your container. So you leave that sit for about 30 minutes to an hour, and it will cure. It will dry and it'll be ready to pour the next layer. Your pot life is about 5 to 12 minutes once you mix A and B together, the silicones. So you want to get to pouring very quickly. So I forgot to talk to build the cylinder inside. I just used a cup here, and I put the cylinder and I poured the muscle layer around the cup. That will give you your to place. Your cavity to place your abscess. So once we
spray that as well.
No, sir.
You do not have to spray the little cup as well.
Oh, the cup. Yeah. Yes, we do. We do spray the
Keep
cup as
honest
well.
Honest for you.
Yes.
It's like most good chefs, they always leave out an ingredient.
Yes,
right?
You do spray the cup so it doesn't stick to the cup.
Thank you.
So then we'll mix our next layer. We'll mix our sub-Q layer. We'll mix that. You do the same thing. Mix A and B. You pour it into another cup. You mix your color in. And you mix it and you pour it. And then you'll get here. Right? So this is this. Let me pull this out of here. So that's kind of what it looks like when you're finished. Okay. The next part is your skin. So here you could just use the lid to pour your skin. Oh, let me talk about the measurements. Your measurements, you just width by length, by the height of the thickness of what you want your skin or your layers to be. So, and then you convert that to milliliters, right? So you could either build single skins that will just go over the top of your trainer like that. And I'll toss it over to Dr. Simon here in a second, and they'll explain to you how to insert the foreign body and how to build the abscess. So you can either build single skins or like we've been doing, because we've been going through a lot of these, we have a big tray here. So we just pour a big tray, again, width by length, by height, depth of your skin, by thickness of your skin, and you just cut it up and at the size of your trainers.
And you want to keep the skins fairly thin. So these are probably about 3 millimeters, give or take. If you add enough of the coloring agent, you can't see through this at all, which is really nice. This way the students don't see where the abscess is. They have to find it. They have to do the surgery.
Okay. So there you go. There, that's your trainer. A quick overview on how to build your trainer. Again, the recipe will be in the PowerPoint that will be shared to you all. And I'm going to toss it over to Dr. Simon. And let me talk about repairs a bit.
Oh yeah, good.
Once you make an incision into your skin, of course you're going to have a hole. You're going to have a cut. These are repairable. You could get about 10 uses out of them, depending on the cut size or the incision size. But the way we repair these, we use a Silico RTV 4500. This is a silicone, and you'll just get some on a stick here on your tongue depressor and just get it on there and just wipe it in, open up the incision, get it inside, put it together, and let it dry. And then be ready for another use. So Dr. Simon, you want to show them how to, let me get your stuff with your employer.
So from start to finish with this project, there is some waiting time. Obviously we like to let this material cure. You know, the product says it's ready for use in a couple of hours. We've just gotten the habit of just leaving it overnight so that we're sure that it's nice and solid. And
but set. You can pour. Within 30 minutes, you can pour a double layer, the second layer on top of this other layer.
Right.
Yes. In about an hour, you can have a trainer.
So then we moved on to the next step, which was the actual abscess material and what we were going to use as our carrier, I guess we want to call it. So we started looking at a variety of different products. Again, we wanted to avoid foodstuffs. And one morning, this really bizarre, I'm brushing my teeth, and I thought to myself, well, there's abrasive in toothpaste. I wonder what that looks like under ultrasound. And sure enough, simple toothpaste and a little bit of saline mixed together. And again, the exact proportions are in the PowerPoint, but it worked really well and showed up phenomenally well on ultrasound. It actually gives these little reflections, so it kind of looks like true abscess material. And you actually can recreate plusostalsis with that material. So that was the first thing, was the toothpaste. I know it somewhat breaks the foodstuffs thing, but maybe not. I don't know. But this worked great. And again, just diluted with a little bit of saline. We tried different techniques. One was actually putting it in the end of a glove, sealing the glove over, and then putting that in the abscess cavity, squirt a ton of ultrasound gel to take up any air spaces, then you can lay this back on top. So first we experimented with glove, decided it was way too labor intensive, pour each finger and hot glue gun it. So we decided to try some other things, and we found these little plastic bags. They work okay. They're really easy to fill and seal. Not completely crazy about the seam over here, but we're working on that part of this too. As far as the foreign body goes, the initial step, just use paper clips. Just cut a paper clip, took a needle driver, and just kind of drove it into this top skin layer so that it was as sub-Q as I could make it. We decided that was okay, but we decided to see if we could do something a little bit better. And what we came up with was AngioCaths. And these work, well, they show up nicely on ultrasound, but essentially all you do with this, you would just kind of drive it in, And then you can just clip the plastic right at the end. Student can't see it, but they can ultrasound it and find it quite easily. So both techniques, either the paper clip or this, these are quite a bit more expensive than paper clips. But if you can get these in bulk, especially, you know, stuff that's expired, you know, their expiration date, you can get plenty of these and they're cheap enough if you do it that way. But this is a really nice technique. No sharp objects for the students to get cut on other than the scalpel that they're using for the abscess drainage. The nice thing about the way we designed this, you can ultrasound it. You can definitely IND it. You can irrigate. You can actually try to numb the surface skin. That part of it isn't the greatest, but again, working on that. But all in all, they can do just about every step of the process for proper incision and drainage and ultrasound guidance for both the abscess component and the foreign body. That's about it for me.
And there's your trainer. It's that easy. It's no time. You can build one. You can build two. You can build three. We've been building. We have about 50 of them now that we use for different programs here at Rocky Vista University. It's really easy. The product's clean. It's fun. Silicone. It's a great material. If you can imagine it, you can create it. I suggest giving it a try and build some other things. Let your imagination take you and just build. It's really simple and it's a lot of fun. Yeah. And it works. It works. It's a great, great material.
So, you know, part of our inspiration here really was, you know, my work with IBSS and how everybody's so great about, you know, sharing what they've learned and then adapting. You know, people team up and try things at different institutions. And this was that kind of process, you know, where it's a group of us, you know, trying to solve a problem and came up with a solution. And then, you know, gradually over time, actually, I would say pretty rapidly over time, if you think about it, in just a couple of years with a couple of different cohorts, have managed to improve it and add so much to it so that the students can really get this experience. Because when the task trainers were $1,400 a piece and they were single use, that really wasn't even an option. But now we can teach this workshop a couple of different times in the year. We can use it for assessment also. I think this would definitely be valuable in a clinical setting also. And again, could be adapted depending on what the specific needs of your institution. So one of the things that we're working on is as we continue to improve this, we want to get the model out there, see what other people have done and if people have suggestions on how to make it even better. So our next step after this, you know, we wanted to share with this community and with you all, you know, definitely get back to us if you have suggestions. We're going to take questions here in a second. But our next step is we would like to publish this on Medit Portal to try to disseminate it to a broader audience so that it can be used. And I'm sure, you know, different institutions are going to have all sorts of takes on how to, you know, improve it, take it to the next level. So, you know, things that we've talked about, some of the really fancy models on the market, which might cost hundreds of thousands of dollars. They have nerves and vessels so that when you're ultrasounding, you know, you get, you know, a more clear picture of different structures rather than simply, you know, just the foreign body. So that's one of the things that we're working on. I think we're constantly in this process of like, how do we make the best abscess? You know, we've talked about, you know, obviously the having it being ultrasound capable is really important. But, you know, how do we make it easy? How do we make it easy cleanup so we can kind of reset the process? We talked about, you know, do we need to add like an odor in there to try to make it more realistic from that standpoint? But, you know, you can get creative. There's a lot of things that you could do. I think Megan has an image for us of the ultrasound that we'd like to share. Megan, if you're able to share your screen for a moment, Dr. Simon just If you would just, you have the expertise of the ultrasound. If you just want to talk about the ultrasound image and if we're able to get that, I don't know. Christine or Megan, if you have it.
Oh, there, no, we go. There we go. Beautiful. Yeah, so these were some of the images that we took off the screen from our ultrasound. The image A on the left, you know, you can clearly see an abscess cavity. And you can see the little kind of sparkly white things. And you can see they even cast shadows below. And again, as you push down on it, you will get some pustostasis. You will see some movement of that material adds to the realism. And the picture B is, I believe, one of the paper clips that we were using for the foreign body, and that's the ultrasound image you got off of that. You know, again, easy for a student, even if they're not proficient at ultrasound, by the structures. And again, the importance of adding in other structures so we can emphasize, hey, before you start cutting, not doing, know what you're dealing with. Ultrasound it first, see if there's any vessels or nerves or anything that may be running close to the abscess. Make sure it's something that you should be draining in your setting, or is this something that may need to go to the OR instead? As far as cost, and we've talked a lot about cost, start to finish, these are about $25.
$15 to $20.
Thank you. He's the guy who does all the purchasing. So so $20 or less. And again, reusable. So if you're in a resource poor environment, you can make one of these and use it dozens of times over, you know, and the only thing you'd have to replace is really the abscess material and then whatever foreign body is pulled out and then just repair that top skin. So yeah, it's pretty inexpensive.
And even after you repaired the top skin, you know, you might, you know, it's going to wear out eventually, but you know, even if you use it 10 or 15 times and had to replace that top skin, you could still use the rest of the plaster.
Oh, yeah.
It would still be functional. So it would just be that very top thin layer.
Yeah. But again, we've used these, you know, we keep producing more of the top skins, but that's about the only thing we've had to replace. And I think the only reason we made 50 of these trainers is we kept tweaking design and different size containers and different amounts of material until we finally came up with this recipe.
So the other thing I'd like to emphasize is, you know, when I came to this sim center, my experience was mostly around using high fidelity simulation and using standardized patients to teach my students. I didn't have hardly any experience actually constructing task trainers, and really grateful to Thomas Jackson here, who has that background and, you know, has expertise in constructing props and that creativity. He also showed me that it's easy. So anybody can do this. So even if you haven't worked with you know, the Dragon Scanner, these kind of products before, it's, if you follow these steps that we just showed you, it's something that you can do at your institution. And you know, you don't need some, you know, you don't need a PhD in chemistry to do this. So
yeah, if you Google or go to YouTube, Smooth On, there's tons of videos and tons of building videos that show you how to use these products. Advanced Materials here in Colorado, in Aurora, Colorado. I think they have online classes that teach you how to build molds, how to use different products. The Smooth On, the Dragon Skin, isn't the only material. There's a whole line of different materials with different densities, with different textures for, again, anything you can imagine. You can create out of these silicone products for sure.
All right, so we wanted to leave plenty of time. We're hoping there's questions. If people want to go ahead and turn on their cameras, if you want to unmute, go ahead and ask your questions. We hope to be able to answer them.
Thank you, Sim Garage. This really is amazing. And thank you for sharing your insights. I mean, imagine it does have to take some creative talent, though. So you said this is easy. Anybody could do this, but it does seem like you do have to have some level of creativity. So I applaud you guys in making these trainers possible. We had one question in the chat so far from Joe, and I think you just mentioned the name as well, and but it slipped my mind. The silicone repair stuff, what's the name of that?
This is from Silco, and it's called RTV 4500. It is high strength silicone sealant. I mean, this is the kind of stuff they use on like boats, and you know, it's a silicone sealer.
Okay. This particular product, we have a cut suits. We use the cut suits, which our cut suits were made by the military. You can do different surgery procedures on them. And the skins are made out of this dragon skin. So they send these and this stuff in the kits to repair. But if you don't have this, all you got to do is mix a little part A, part B, get it in here on your skin, and let it dry. It's going to take longer, but That's another alternative. But this stuff works really well, and it goes really fast. I prefer to use this for healing and repairing.
Great. There's another question. This is more logistical. Where will you be posting your PowerPoint for future access?
So we'll share it through IPSS, so whoever signed up to attend the webinar, we'll start directly that way. And then I know we have the webinars are archived on the website. So hopefully we can attach the PowerPoint there. But in the near future, we hope to submit to MedEd Portal, which if you're not familiar, MedEd Portal, I'm sure most of the audience is familiar, but you know, it's a repository for educational materials. It's a peer-reviewed PubMed index site, but they have, you know, it's a package deal. So you include everything that one would need in order to conduct the activity. So we would include the PowerPoint as well as a list of materials, maybe even this webinar, and then as well as our educational materials, which would include the objectives, the corresponding competencies and EPAs for teaching this, and then also the assessment tool that we used with the PA students, which could easily be used or modified for physician students as well as learners at other levels.
Great. We have another question. And remember, everyone, if you're able to, you can turn your cameras on. We'd love to hear and see you. This is from Jay Podini and asking, can you please show or post a model already prepared? And I think you have some samples there if we could get a better look at them.
Yeah, I was going to say, you sneak around here for a second. So when it's all, there we go. I got the camera right there. Okay. So when it's all said and done, you have this cavity here. Okay. And that's where you're going to put your abscess material, either in the finger of a glove or a little plastic bag, whatever you're going to use. But that would sit in this little cavity. You're going to take up all the air spaces with ultrasound gel. Then you lay your top skin on and now you're good to go. If the student wants ultrasound, again, ultrasound gel, good to go. And they're all ready to start. They can palpate it, and you can definitely see there's a fluctuant soft spot the way we've designed this. So they can palpate it or they can ultrasound, but that's essentially kind of what it would look like, you know, as we do that. So we don't have any abscess material, unfortunately, to show, but we'll get that. Yeah. Oh, he's taking a step. Okay. Tom's need to get that.
And then did you have, what were some of the other ones? You had the one that had like the different coloring of the tissue layers.
Yeah, so this one, okay. Yeah, this one. Yep. Yeah, so the red was the first layer that was poured, okay?
Ah, okay.
And then,
here's the one with the first
yeah,
layer.
Take it out.
So you can see it, you can see it underneath.
Yeah, so this is,
perfect.
Yeah. So, and again, so that's just a little cavity. The first time we experimented with it, yeah, go ahead, throw that in there.
So you just put the little baggie in. Again, lots of ultrasound gel, lay your skin on top, good to go. You know, they can prep it, numb it, cut it, irrigate, pretty much everything that you'd want to do on it on the procedure. And again, we like the fact that I think this particular skin, I think this one's been used probably several times just looking at the damage on it. But again, it still is okay as is. You know, eventually it gets to the point where we just need to make a new one, but that's not a huge expense. Because again, each time you make one of these, you can use it again and again and again and again. So it's kind of nice in that respect.
Yeah, absolutely. Great that they're reusable.
Yeah, just the thought of, you know, buying something for $35, you know, $50 a pop, and then throwing it out. It's, you know, I just, that bothered me a lot. And same with, you know, using animal products. I mean, the food waste is phenomenal. Imagine doing 400 students, how much steak or chicken breast or whatever you'd be using. And again, it's just, you know, the health risks of handling raw animal products. And they got to be sitting out all day. You know, that's the problem. You run these labs and you start in the morning and you're hoping to be done by the late afternoon. Depends on how many students you're running through the particular exercise.
Agree. Do we have any more questions from the audience? Is there anything that you were really hoping people would ask? Like, I need, you want anything else you just want to share? Like, I really need to get this message out.
I'm curious if there's, for the audience is watching, does this make you think of any other task trainer, whether it's similar to this or even, you know, a few steps removed, they're like, oh, I wish there was a cheap, you know, inexpensive, easy to make version of a task trainer to do this. Like, what are the needs or what do people, you know, see as the, what would be most useful in the setting that you work in?
Good question. See if we have any responses. I know on our end, it's always airway trainers.
A little tougher, but I'm sure we can figure that one out too. It's not tiny enough, you know, air time. We'll definitely do it.
If people have thoughts or if they're, if you're able to make this trainer or something like this at your institution, I mean, definitely share with us because, you know, we'd be curious to see, you know, what others are doing along these lines. So that we can, you know, kind of continue this back and forth process. But thank you, Christine.
There's one more question.
You got a
response. IV line, central line, arterial line insertion, nerve blocks, things like that. Those are good topics.
That actually is kind of interesting because we've been talking about that, about adding, you know, nerves and arteries to our test trainer. So we are in the process of doing that. If the student doesn't actually puncture the artery with the needle, we may be okay. So hopefully they'll have good ultrasound technique and not go stabbing into whatever we're going to use for the artery. But that's the next step, is start adding more structures like nerve artery vein into the training.
That's great. Here's another comment about sebaceous cyst lipoma cellulitis.
There are task trainers on the market specific for sebaceous cyst. They're single use only. There's really no reason that you couldn't modify this and call it a sebaceous cyst. You know, if you made, you know, if you, instead of putting if you were to only have a maybe half as deep, so that way it would look more like a sebaceous cyst. The other thing you can do with this top skin, feel free to add a little theatrical makeup to it. You can make it look like cellulitis, just, you know, dab a little bit of the makeup on. kind of like what we use for our standardized patients, you know, just dab a little theatrical makeup, make it look like whatever you want to.
Moulage.
Yeah, moulage.
Well, and it would be fun to have different task trainers. You know, you could have a sebaceous cyst, you could have abscess, you could have cellulitis, and then, force the students or the learners to, you know, examine them and, you know, kind of differentiate between just visually looking at it, you know, trying to make a diagnosis versus using ultrasound. That would be a great expansion of this.
Okay. And their comment was, yes, we can develop similar kinds of modules. And then there was a comment from Vanessa. Great presentation. When will we have access to the recording?
That's the IPSS. That's you guys.
Yeah. Yes. Let's see. I'm looking for Megan McCray as our IPSS staff. So I know she'll get this posted and turned around onto our site. I'm not sure of the time frame.
Yes. So actually, I was thinking we'll probably get it out in the next day or so. So to do a quick turnaround with this. So once we get the video edited, then we will send it right over.
Okay, great.
Right. We will make sure you have the PowerPoint today also, so we can package those together. And then we'll include our contact information in that PowerPoint. So if anybody wants to reach out to us, we do enjoy collaborating and hearing how people are using it. So feel free to reach out. Thank you, everyone. And we know everybody has a busy day, so thanks for making time to join us. And we hope to see you next time in the Sims Garage.
We'll be there. Thank you. It was a pleasure.